Yeah, they might.
6:25.
Oh, 6:25.
Excuse me.
We now know.
Arizona is a state located east of California, west of New Mexico.
These mics live.
At one time, the ramps were in LA at one time.
Yeah, they turned on the Tesla.
And I hear that LA might get a team coming back.
They're trying to get the Rams back.
I know. And the owner.
It's funny, because it's LA wants them back, and they're not gonna relocate LA. Did you see that part?
No.
They're gonna be like.
Yeah, he knows now.
Oh, you're 60 miles out of town or something.
Well, there's a couple stadiums, one's in, I don't know what they're doing with all the old, you know, the one stadium was the one where they had the Olympics, right? Coliseum, that's in LA.
That's in LA, yeah.
That's in LA.
But apparently, you're not gonna use it. Where are you going?
Going down. You're gonna hide down below this?
I know there's a requirement.
It's over there.
That was the one that lowered me down, too.
Oh, yeah.
Yo, what's up?
I know that lady.
But they've got a new one in Harbor City, a stadium, and a new soccer and stuff in it, and you can use it for football.
If you pull out, it goes back. Push in and it locks it. Hey.
Robert.
Will you pull mine and let it come back there? Oh, thank you. Robert? Are you praying? Are you praying already?
We're gonna have fun tonight.
Yeah.
So you gave me this, and I dropped it.
No, no. We bailed out at one. I couldn't miss this. Next year.
Okay. They got cities and towns.
We only got three items on the agenda.
Adjourn's what I like.
Yeah, call to order. We can skip two and just do adjourn.
That doesn't look like Chino to me.
No. Chino high rises here.
Hey, you missed a good presentation at lunchtime.
Lunchtime?
Yeah.
At lunchtime?
Yesterday, at lunchtime.
Oh, I was, yesterday at lunchtime, I was just climbing up out of the canyon without an elk.
Probably.
You don't know for sure?
No.
Thanks for your information.
Well, they don't look local because they're too dressed up.
Who stuffed up? You want candy or coffee? Who wants candy? I've been rejected again.
Susie!
Are we fighting?
Is Lon not gonna be here tonight?
Hopefully he'll be here. He said he would.
Hey, what was I just asking for? Asking him. I didn't know where you went. Didn't say a word.
Talk to your attorney. Yeah, this hurts my property values. I can come back. Well, that wasn't, but we didn't know about that till.
Yeah, and later on.
Later on. So I requested, if something like that's going on.
Oh, yeah.
And so, yeah, man.
Because all it does is mislead you. Let me show you something.
Misleads everybody.
I was gonna show you.
Eight people got up and talked. How many people were there? But in previous meetings, they filled the place, and it took, it was 1 and 2 hour things. That doesn't.
Everybody got quiet.
Uh-huh.
Do
a witching hour getting close. Hey, what are you doing, that clock or that clock?
Whichever one gets us out early.
We can.
Let's start by that one and quit by this one.
I guess we could look at the screen.
Okay. Let him look at the screen.
Apparently not. We'll go ahead and get started.
Have to move the sign.
No, just stay there.
We're fine. Keep her in the corner.
All right. Okay. We'll go ahead and call this meeting to order. May we have the roll call, Ms. Lewis?
You certainly may. Good evening. Councilmember Chuka.
Here.
Oops. Here. Councilmember Miller.
Yes.
Councilmember Mendoza.
Here.
Councilmember Best.
Here.
Vice Mayor Croft.
Here.
Mayor Marley.
Here.
And Lon Turner at this moment is absent.
Okay. Hopefully he'll be here in a few moments. Tonight's study session is on zoning ordinances affecting marijuana, medical marijuana growing facilities. I realize this is an emotional subject, but we're here to conduct town business, so I would ask everyone to show respect to one another. There, we will be having two presentations, and then we will receive public input. I would ask that you hold your comments to 3 minutes so that everyone else has a chance to speak. I'm going to go ahead and read the council meeting public participation rules. It's the council's desire to hear public comment on regular and special meeting agenda items. Because it's important to maintain order during the meeting, members of the public are expected to observe the same rules of propriety and decorum applicable to members of the council. Personal, impertinent, or slanderous remarks are not acceptable. Persons not conducting themselves in an acceptable manner will be warned by the chairperson. Any person persisting in such conduct will be removed by the sergeant at arms. The citizens of Chino Valley have asked their elected officials to look into some means of limiting the number of medical marijuana growing facilities within the town. That's why we're here tonight, to discuss possible changes in our zoning ordinances toward that end. Tonight's meeting is a study session only. There will be no voting by council. So we're going to receive information, but we can't vote because this is a study session. Item two on our agenda is consideration and discussion of proposed amendments to the UDO further regulating the manner and placement of medical marijuana uses in the town of Chino Valley. Ms. Mayday, I believe you're up.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Oh, wait, are you doing that? There we go. We're fighting over control. I'm glad to be back before you this evening to discuss the research that staff has done and the public comment that Planning and Zoning has taken at its regular meeting on November 3rd, a special meeting on November 17th, and then again during its regular meeting on December 1st. I think it's worthwhile to go back through the history so that everybody understands what it is that the town has done to this point. In 2003, the voters of the state of Arizona approved, in 2010, the voters approved Proposition 203, which legalized medical marijuana in the state of Arizona. April of that year, the Planning and Zoning Commission held a public hearing to take comment on recommendations to town council. Later on that same year in May, the town council referred the matter back to staff to consider a 500-foot separation from churches in addition to the proposed separations that in the first ordinance. In March of 2012, the Planning and Zoning held another public hearing and recommended no separation between the churches and medical marijuana uses. And at the April meeting of 2012, the town council decided to abide solely by the state regulations in place at that time. At that time and to this day, the regulations for the state is 500 feet separation between schools, public and private. In September 2013, town council directed staff to again research and draft medical marijuana regulations. After public hearings and work sessions, the Planning and Zoning Commission forwarded amendments to the Town Council with recommendations for approval. In December of 2010, the Town Council adopted Ordinance 13-779, regulating the manner and placement of medical marijuana uses. In March of 2014, the Town Council adopted Resolution 14-1025, opposing the legalization of recreational marijuana. And in April of 14, Town Council adopted Resolution 14030, supporting a tax on medical marijuana growing facilities. For this current round of review, the council took public comment at their October 27th regular meeting. The Planning and Zoning Commission conducted an additional citizen review and comment at the November 3rd meeting. We held a public hearing at the special meeting on November 17th, 2015, and further discussed and made recommendation at the December 1, 2015 meeting. We're here tonight for the study session on December 10th, 2015. And the next date on the calendar would be the regular Town Council meeting on January 12, 2016. Okay. There are two things that regulate medical marijuana in the state of Arizona. The Arizona Medical Marijuana Act, which is, can be found in the Arizona Revised Statutes 36-2801. And in that act, the legislature directs the Arizona Department of Health Services to develop regulations for how the medical marijuana industry is to be regulated in terms of what's required for dispensary, who can work there, what kind of qualifications they have to have, what kind of background checks. So again, in both the Arizona Revised Statutes and the Department of Health Services regulations, the only separation that they mandate is 500 feet from schools, public or private, that existed before the date the dispensary submitted the initial dispensary registration certificate application. So that's when this started in 2010 up till December of 2013, when council adopted the ordinance number 13779, this was the only regulation in place in the town. These are the regulations for the surrounding communities. The Yavapai County abides by the state rules for the dispensaries. Cultivation sites are limited to industrial. City of Prescott abides by the state regulations, and Prescott Valley's is a little bit more elaborate. They have cultivation in commercial heavy and 500 feet of separation from schools, places of worship, public parks or buildings, colleges, and so forth. We have to look at what is allowed by law when we deal with issues like this, and what the facts are related to how medical marijuana is legal, how the town can regulate the manner and placement, what the federal regulations may or may not be, and so forth. So I wanted to take a minute and talk about the facts that we need to be paying attention to this evening. The facts as to the use of medical marijuana in the state of Arizona are that the voters of the state approved Proposition 203. It was a slim margin, but it was approved. Both the state revised statutes and the Department of Health Services have set out regulations for the use and manner and placement and management of medical marijuana in the state. Like I said, the section of ARS directs the Arizona Department of Health Services to adopt additional rules above and beyond those set forth in state law. So at the end of the day, medical marijuana is a legal use in the state of Arizona, and we have to deal with that fact. In terms of the manner and placement in Chino Valley, the town council that was sitting in 2010 discussed amendments to the UDO and declined to amend the UDO, deciding instead to impose the state's loan separation requirement of 500 feet from public and or private schools. And this is important when we, later on, we're going to be looking at where the existing medical marijuana cultivation facilities are, and this is very important when we get to that point. In 2013, again, the council directed staff to start working on some proposed amendments to the UDO, and in December of 2013, the town council adopted ordinance 13779, which set forth the regulations we have today. In regards to the regulation of marijuana by the federal government, possession and use of marijuana in the United States has been illegal since 1937. It was classified as a Schedule I drug in the 70s. The Department of Justice is precluded by the 2014 Appropriations Bill from using its fund to enforce federal laws regarding marijuana in states that have legalized it. It's called the Rohrabacher-Farr Amendment, and there was a recent case that was decided in October of this year supporting the fact that the DEA cannot use federal funds, to go after legally functioning medical marijuana facilities in states where medical marijuana is legal. There has also been a memo issued by the Department of Justice where they have reprioritized enforcement, focusing their efforts on keeping marijuana out of the hands of minors, stopping resulting cash flow to gangs, cartels, and other things, rather than pursuing the medical marijuana avenue. So the DEA is limited in their ability to prosecute in states where medical marijuana is legal. The facts surrounding how this works with zoning in Chino Valley, a non-conforming use is something that we need to talk about, because if council decides to adopt text amendments, it is possible that we could create some non-conforming uses. We define a non-conforming use as a structure or land which was lawfully established and maintained prior to the adoption of this ordinance or any amendment thereto, or annexation to the town, which does not conform to the use regulations for the district in which it is located. A text amendment to the UDO can change the legal status of a structure or property from legal conforming to legal non-conforming use. The UDO goes on to prohibit non-conforming uses from expanding. Non-conforming buildings or land shall not be expanded on in any way that enlarges or enforces the nonconformity. In 2006, the voters approved the Private Property Rights Protection Act. This again was a voter initiative approved statewide. And the regulations for this are in Title 12. And the act requires just compensation for diminution of value or diminishing or devaluing property that results from enactment or applicability of any land use law after the date the property was transferred to the owner. We'll talk a little bit more about Prop 207 in a minute, but this requires relief to property owners whose property values have been diminished by any land use regulation enacted by the town after they have acquired the property. Phyllis is going to correct me.
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
I don't mean to actually correct Ruth, but I think she's phrased it a little differently than what the act actually says. What the act actually says and does is it gives a property owner a cause of action to go sue mm-hmm. the town. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't require the town to give compensation to every property owner, only if they bring an action against the town.
Right.
And prevail.
And I have a more elaborate explanation later. Mm. So when we get down to the end of all of this, this is what we have to deal with. The fact that the medical marijuana is a legal use in Arizona, that the town has the ability to regulate land uses within the corporate boundary of the town, that Proposition 207 requires relief to property owners whose property values have been diminished by land use laws adopted after they have acquired real property. So we have these kind of competing interests here, and the staff has tried to bring forward information so that we can land somewhere in the middle. Mm-hmm. In terms of policy, the federal government regulates interstate commerce. They regulate drug laws through the FDA and enforcement of federal, they enforce the federal laws. In terms of state policy, the state regulates commerce within the state. The voter mandates are, or propositions are, things that the voters mm-hmm. approve. And then what local policy can regulate, or the town's policy can regulate, is manner and placement of land uses deemed legal in the state of Arizona. This is what we regulate, is just this box, the manner and placement of land uses that are legal in the state of Arizona. So I want to talk a little bit more about Prop 207, or the Private Property Rights Act. And so just running through some of the language here, and Phyllis, if I'm not being accurate, please let me know. If the existing rights to use, divide, sell, or process private real property are reduced by the enactment or applicability of any land use law enacted after the date the property is transferred to the owner, and such action reduces the fair market value of the property, the owner is entitled to just compensation from the state or political subdivision of this state that enacted the land use law. The state or the political subdivision of the state that enacted the land use law has the burden of demonstrating that the land use law is exempt pursuant to subsection B. And subsection B lists some specific examples land use actions that are exempt. The owner shall not be required to first submit a land use application to remove, modify, vary, or otherwise alter the application of the land use law to the owner's property as a prerequisite to demanding and receiving just compensation pursuant to this section. I'm not done yet. And again, if the land, they bring a claim to the town, we have 90 days to respond. If a land law continues to apply to private real property more than 90 days after the owner of the property makes a written demand in a specific amount for just compensation to the state or the public political subdivision of this state that enacted the land use law, the owner has a cause of action for just compensation in a court in the county in which the property is located, unless the state or the political subdivision of this state and the owner reach an agreement on the amount of just compensation to be paid, or unless the state or the political subdivision of this state amends, repeals, or issues to the landowner a binding waiver of enforcement of the land use law on the owner's specific parcel. So in essence, we can exempt specific parcels of land from that law. We've gotten some objections, and we've heard the same objections several times. Some of them have been in regards to kids who are getting a hold of marijuana through people who have a medical marijuana card. That's a law enforcement issue, and that's a Department of Health Services enforcement issue. If that's going on, people need to get a hold of the police, and they need to get a hold of Department of Health Services, because those cards can be revoked. Again, with the federal law, we can't enforce federal law. The feds have said that they're going to be limited in what they enforce, and that if people are unhappy with the way the feds are or are not enforcing those laws, then you need to contact your representatives in D.C. Senator Flake, Senator McCain, and Congressman Gosar are the ones you need to be talking to. Again, interestingly enough, that when the votes were all tallied, this measure failed in Yavapai County. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we don't have the ability to exempt ourselves from the rest of the state, so we have to abide by this. And there's a lot of discussion of whether or not the medical marijuana has any real medical value. That's something that the Federal Drug Administration decides when they review drugs, when they license drugs. That's something that the FDA determines and not us. So I wanted to go to this map because this is kind of interesting. rather than show everybody where it's legal, I wanted to show everybody where medical marijuana cultivation facilities are not allowed. So all of the black you see up here, no cultivation facilities are allowed there. The color, this up here is was part of Del Rio Ranch. And then we have a couple of spots along here, along 89, that are commercial, either commercial heavy or commercial light. And then this is the gravel pit out behind Haystack. That's Fletcher's gravel pit. Those are the, these are the only areas with the existing regulations that we have right now where medical marijuana cultivation can be. All right, so I wanted to talk about where these cultivation facilities are right now. You can see this small circle right here. This property that's the northeast corner of the intersection of 1 East and Perkinsville Road. This property, the old KOA, and then there's another small private farm here. Those three properties were already cultivating or in the process of cultivating prior to the adoption of Ordinance 13779. The remaining three, this, this, and now this one, have all come online since that time. We have interest in some other parcels. I've spoken to people who have been looking at a lot of different sites throughout town. Again, if you look at this, their choices are pretty limited. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
I just wanted to reference the date the town council adopted ordinance 13779 in December of 2013. So those three growth facilities in the circle existed prior to December of 2013.
Correct. So in essence, since we've adopted that ordinance, we've only added three. Again, there's been discussion of cultivation facilities and water and how that works. Because of the water situation in Arizona, we have ADWR who tells us how we can use water. For ADWR's purposes, if you have a plant where the roots are in a container and not attached to the ground, that's considered an industrial use. For exempt wells constructed after 1983 or pre-declaration, they are entitled to 10 acre feet a year. For those constructed before that, they are entitled to 56 acres a year. General service customer, if they have availability to general service water, they're just a regular municipal customer. If the roots are actually in the ground, it's an agricultural use. With an exempt well, you can irrigate 2 acres a year. Anything more than that requires irrigation grandfathered rights. They have wells that are metered and monitored by ADWR. In general service water, we have a limited general service water system. Anyone that had a cultivation facility that wanted to connect to the general service water would be treated like any other industrial user. Yes, sir.
I'm sorry to keep interrupting
you. No, go right ahead. Excuse me for a second. Did you need? Oh, talk into the mic. Okay, great. While we're interrupted, these are some of the things that we're not going to be dealing with tonight. We're not going to deal with the legality or the morality of marijuana, the amount of water used by it. What we're looking at tonight is zoning regulations and zoning regulations alone. Continue.
Thank you, sir. During the meeting on December 1st, the Planning and Zoning Commission, after having three public hearings, so to speak, on this. We, the commission developed, the staff developed some proposed amendments that the Planning and Zoning Commission voted to forward to town council for consideration. First of all, would it be allow cultivation facilities as an on-site only use, which means they would have to be physically attached to a dispensary. Currently, the Arizona Department of Health Services regulations restrict the number of dispensaries to one per CHA or community health assessment area. So the town already has one dispensary. Unless the state regulations were changed to allow more than one, we would not have any more. Now, that being said, the state also requires that we have reasonable regulations. Option number two would be to remove cultivation and infusion facilities from conditional uses in AR36, AR5, and AR4 zoning districts. Larger parcels of land near electrical use utilities are generally zoned AR5 and AR4. Right now, they're conditional use permits, and that require a conditional use permit requires the same public hearing process as a zoning amendment. Option number three, of course, has three sub-options. The initial option is to remove cultivation, infusion, and dispensary facilities from permitted uses in commercial light, commercial heavy, and industrial zoning districts and require a conditional use permit. Permitted uses are not required to undergo any additional scrutiny by the public, by town council. So to require conditional use permits would require them again to go through that same process that a zoning text amendment or a zoning map change would require. 3A would be to require a conditional use permit for any medical marijuana facility in an industrial zoning district only. 3B would require a conditional use permit for any medical marijuana facility in commercial heavy and industrial districts only. And C would allow them as a conditional use permit in commercial light, commercial heavy, and industrial districts. Another option was to require 500 feet of separation from churches in addition to the already specified uses. That would further restrict some of the land area available for development as cultivation site. Practically speaking, most churches are located in proximity to residential zoning districts, if not smack in the middle of them. Options five and six are to measure the separation from property line to property line and exclude public right-of-way for the measurement of separation. So in, for instance, if we look at, let me see, where's my map? Can you open that folder and see if there's a zoning map in there? That's the one. Thank you. Okay. So this is the zoning map, obviously. Let me see if I can shrink it down a little bit. Yeah. That's good enough. So if you look at the, if State Route 89 is ADOT public right-of-way. So when you were measuring from a, for instance, this is a residential zoning district. Instead of measuring from this side over 500 feet, you would exclude the 200 feet here and start from the far side and measure 500 feet. So it, in essence, would add distance to the separation. So if you were on a street that has a 25-foot wide dedicated public right-of-way, it would be 525 feet to the medical marijuana. All right, now I need to go. All right. Proposed option seven is to limit the size of a cultivation facilities to 3,000 square feet or another specific size limit with appeal to the Board of Adjustment. This is bonnie plants that we're looking at the bottom. Each greenhouse is approximately 12,000 square feet, and the area in the blue box at the bottom is approximately 3,000 square feet.
Please, for our audience's benefit, this is bonnie plants.
This is bonnie plants. Bonnie plants is not growing medical marijuana. I want to be clear. No. They are not. This is just one that I thought everybody would know and recognize and be able to get some idea in their mind of how big, what 3,000 and 12,000 square feet really look like. I want to be clear about that. So again, we recommended forwarding all seven options to the to town council, and you can discuss accordingly.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any questions before our next presentation? Mr. Mendoza?
No.
Mr. Best.
I got one, yeah.
Sure.
I was under, or maybe I have two. First of all, our dispensary is a nonprofit.
Yes.
So it makes no money. It just goes ahead and whatever the grower says is what it has to charge.
I'll let the attorneys from the growers talk about that.
And second of all, is that attached to a grower in town?
Is there a tax by the...
Attached.
Oh, attached. I'm sorry.
Is that, according to what you were saying earlier...
Oh, I understand what you're saying.
Only one dispensary who is attached to a grower per town.
There's one dispensary per community health assessment area. There is allowed one dispensary by the Arizona Department of Health Services regulations.
Okay.
What we're one of the proposed options is to require on-site cultivation only. If you remember, when we first adopted these regulations, we eliminated outdoor growing.
Correct.
Said no outdoor grows. So council could also say no off-site grows. So in order for another grow facility to come on, if that's one of the options that council decides to adopt, we could not have another grow facility unless the state of Arizona Department of Health Services changed that rule, limiting the number of dispensaries to one per CHA. The CHA here includes Chino Valley, Paulden, and Ash Fork, basically.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Mendoza.
I did have. On April 22nd of 2014, Town Council adopts Resolution 14-1030 supporting a tax on marijuana growth facilities.
Correct.
What is that? I'm sorry. I didn't do my homework on that.
Oh, no. I'll answer that one. Because that one, I submitted it to the League of Cities and Towns, and this year I'm resubmitting it. At that point in time, it didn't go through, but we're going to resubmit it.
Okay.
And I believe, Mr. Best, for clarification, I believe we do receive taxes from the dispensary, but not from any grows.
Correct. The dispensary, as I understand it, charges sales tax, so we do receive our share of that.
Okay. I wanted to clarify that.
Well, that I understood. I was just wondering if we had a particular grow facility attached to that dispensary.
Right.
No, the dispensary we have now, we do not have a grow facility attached to it. The product that they sell at the dispensary here is grown in Prescott Valley.
Okay, thank you.
Did you skip me?
He probably did.
I probably did. Go ahead.
Initially, you said that they tried to do the 500-foot separation from churches, but they couldn't.
No, they chose not to.
They chose not to. Gotcha. Okay, I missed that part. And then the grandfathered rights, or in other words, that one section where you said, is that kind of like doing a grandfathered in?
We don't for the rigid word grandfathered.
Oh, sorry.
It's a legal nonconforming. We have fancy words for this.
Okay. So your legal nonconforming whatever.
Yes.
That's what that one part of that law, what that stipulation was on the Prop 207 or whatever it was.
So kind of. So what we're talking about with the legal nonconforming use is, let's scroll down here. So for instance, if town council were to say, okay, we're only going to have medical marijuana cultivation facilities in industrial by conditional use only. Mm-hmm. These are not an industrial zoning district, so they become a legal nonconforming use. As such, they cannot expand their use from what they have right now, which is where we may get into some Prop 207 issues.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Any questions on this side? Okay. We have in the town a number of legal nonconforming.
Yes.
The entire town is.
Pretty much. It'd be easier to count the ones that are not.
Okay. My grandfather did. Legal nonconforming grandfathers.
Yes.
Thank you.
That's a definite maybe.
And we hear about those on a regular basis. All right. If there's no further questions for Ms. Mady, we have a presentation by a Mr. Conant. Yes, sir. And this is dealing with laws regarding marijuana, correct?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
All righty. You're all set. You get to draw.
Okay. Just from this mouse right here. My name is Paul Conant. Mm-hmm. I'm a lawyer, and I represent Al Abrams, and he's seated in the front row with me. He's the man in the tan slacks. Mm-hmm. And he's a grower and co-owner of the one of the cultivation facilities that you've heard about, mm-hmm. Ms. Mady referred to as the old KOA campground, right. That's in that circle that she highlighted, mm-hmm. For you earlier. I've come up here for two of the Planning and Zoning Commission meetings, talked briefly both times, but mostly tried to listen, and mm-hmm. I've got notes on about 40 people who have spoken at the Planning and Zoning Commission mm-hmm. Meetings. What we asked for permission to do, I just represent one of these cultivation yes, sir. Facilities here. I don't represent them all, mm-hmm. And I don't represent the dispensary. But my client feels like he's part of the community. He's been part of the community for mm-hmm. a number of years, never had any problems, and we know that this is a matter of obviously public concern and would like to, mm-hmm. to speak to the matter as well, too. The structure of this presentation is based on what we heard when we came and listened to those 40 people talk, and it seems to be things that a lot of people were concerned about. It might deviate a little bit off topic from zoning, okay. And if you want to tell me to go faster or sit down or go back or whatever, yeah. That's fine with me. Also, if you have questions and you want to interrupt, that's fine. I can accommodate that as well, too.
Okay, if that's all right with council, we will, as a particular panel comes up, if you have a question, feel free to just raise your hand, okay?
Okay.
Yes, sir. I had understood that this presentation dealt with a lot of our legalities that we're facing, so we're looking forward to that.
It does. Yes, good, bad, or indifferent, I mm-hmm. I seem to know a lot about those things, so yes, I'm going to try to give you an overview. There's a state level, as Ms. Mady was saying, there's a federal aspect that I'm going to talk about, and then there's the local level, and there are some things in here that I think are not well understood generally by anybody, even people that have studied it. Most of the comments that we've heard from people who have been speaking at the Planning and Zoning Commission meetings that I've attended are very good comments. People they're educating themselves. Mm-hmm. They're researching before they come in. They're not just coming in and making random comments. But these are some things that are just hard to find unless you've really studied it, so I want to go over some of those things for you. We call it the medical marijuana overview, and this is a timeline. A lot of times I think people forget that the statute was passed 5 years ago. It was passed in November of 2010, and so we're obviously in December of 2015. We're 5 years down the road with this statute. The effective date, of course, when it's adopted by the electorate, it's not immediately effective, but the effective date was in early 2011. There have been legal challenges, and you might have read about those. There was a legal challenge. The Arizona governor made a challenge to implementation of the Arizona Medical Marijuana Act. That matter was litigated in federal court, and the challenge was denied. It was rejected. So there was an attempt to slow down or stop implementation of the act, and it was unsuccessful. Shortly after that, the rules that govern the program were filed by the Arizona Department of Health Services with the Secretary of State that, as you probably know, makes those rules the official program rules. Then in May of 2012, Department of Health Services began accepting applications for what are called dispensary registration certificates. This is the name of the document that DHS will give to a not-for-profit entity that gives them permission under the AMA, Arizona Medical Marijuana Act, to conduct business. And in this presentation, I'm also going to talk to you a little bit about how, generally speaking, the industry operates, because I think that's something that you may want to know about as well, too. I think actually people know a lot about it, but there's, again, some nuances that I'm going to try to cover. So further in the timeline, in August of 2012, that's when the Department of Health Services held a lottery for people who wanted to get one of those dispensary registration certificates in these CHAs. There's 200 CHAs, roughly, in the state of Arizona. And in 69 of those CHAs, there was more than one applicant. Some of the CHAs had many applicants. You're located in what's called the Chino Valley Ash Fork CHA. CHA stands for Community Health Assessment Area. That is a pre-existing template overlay that the Arizona Department of Health Services already had in place. And so they just simply used it for purposes of trying to implement the act as required by law. The lottery was on the internet. You could go watch the lottery on the internet, and the results were published on the website. So that led to the opening of the first dispensary. It was approved to open in December of 2012. And I think it actually opened its doors in early, maybe January, February of 2013. Federal law is something that a lot of people have questions about, because it's known that under the federal statute, the CSA, Controlled Substances Act, marijuana is illegal. Even medical marijuana, if you read the statute, it's illegal. The Controlled Substances Act has no exceptions. If you were to go read the statute, it doesn't have any exceptions for medical marijuana. However, there are, in practice, exceptions. And one of the exceptions is something called the Cole Memo. And Mr. Cole is a deputy U.S. attorney. And in August of 2013, with the approval of the executive branch, authored the Cole Memo that gives direction to all the U.S. attorneys in the United States. And basically what it says is, we're, as Ms. Mayday indicated in her presentation, federal law enforcement priority is going to be directed towards illegal activity, not the state medical marijuana programs. When you look at the Cole Memo, and it's maybe 4 or 5 pages long, it makes it very clear what the enforcement priorities are, and we'll talk about it in just a couple minutes. The thing that I want to pause just and just ask you to consider for a moment, if you were in the medical marijuana business and you knew that you could be essentially immune from federal prosecution if you stayed within the confines of the State Medical Marijuana Act, but if you stepped outside the confines of the State Medical Marijuana Act, you'd probably do everything in your power to stay within the confines of the State Medical Marijuana Act to avoid having federal prosecution. So I can tell you that my clients are very compliance-oriented. They want no trouble with federal law enforcement. So in addition to the Cole Memo, there's this Rohrabacher-Farr Amendment that Ms. Mayday referred to earlier, and I want to talk to you a little bit about how that works. I call it defunding legislation, okay? So I'll start with the Cole Memo. Here's a copy of the first page of it. You can find it on the internet. You can Google the Cole memo. And I pulled out some of the key language there, but basically it says that federal law enforcement priorities are going to be directed towards illegal activities and not medical marijuana. So if you're within the lines, if you stay within the lines of your state program, and by the way, I think it's 24 states and the District of Columbia now have medical marijuana programs. If you stay within the lines of that program, the federal law enforcement is not going to either investigate or prosecute. Mm-hmm. That's important. They will not investigate or prosecute. This is the defunding legislation. Mm-hmm. And where do you find this? This is in one of those bills that every year goes to Congress, where they come up with a budget, and they have a big debate about what's going to be in the budget and what's not going to be in the budget, and what are we going to spend our money on. And since 2014, and it was just renewed again this year, and so it'll apply to 2016 budget, which was just approved as well, none of the federal funds in the federal budget can be used, and I highlighted Arizona on there so you can see it, mm-hmm. No federal funds can be used essentially for enforcement or investigation mm-hmm. if somebody, again, is within the lines of the state program. So we'll talk in a minute about why understanding the lines of the state program is important. But if you wanted to look it up, there's the title of the Appropriations Acts, and that's what you hear about on the news every year. Everybody talks about the budget and are we going to be balanced, and that's where you find this. So Congress has the power to defund law enforcement and to say to all the federal agencies that would otherwise regulate marijuana, medical or not, under the Controlled Substances Act, you can't spend money on enforcement of medical marijuana. So people say, is medical marijuana legal under federal law or illegal? Well, I say, this is me talking, I say yes and no, because yes, it's illegal under the Controlled Substances Act, but no, there's not going to be any U.S. attorney doing anything about it, and there's not going to be any law enforcement people doing about it because Congress didn't give them any money to do anything about it. Okay. There is the case that Ms. Mayday mentioned. The federal judge in California recently told the government, the Department of Justice, that statute, that defunding legislation, essentially means what it says. Section 538 is plain on its face, and the court must enforce it according to its terms. So the federal judge there said, no, you can't do any medical marijuana enforcement. Okay? So at least going forward through 2016, that's the status quo with respect to federal law. Now, this is the thing that, I know a lot of people are upset. They think, well, what, you know, shouldn't the federal government be doing something about this? How can the states possibly do this? And I want to give you an explanation for, this is my opinion, why I think the federal government has made the choices that they have made mm-hmm. about not funding enforcement. There's a provision in the Internal Revenue Code that's called Section 280E. And this is the federal statute that governs how much money goes to Washington, D.C., and who has to send the money to Washington. So when you look at Section 280E, what it says is nobody who's engaged in a business that is illegal as a matter of federal statute mm-hmm. can take tax deductions. So, for instance, if you're in the medical marijuana business, because remember, my answer is medical marijuana illegal federally? I say yes and no. Yes, it's illegal under the Controlled Substances Act. No, they don't act like it's illegal. Hmm. Why is that? Well, under the Internal Revenue Code, anybody who's engaged in the medical marijuana business, because remember, it's still technically illegal under the Controlled Substances Act, can't deduct their business expenses on their taxes. Let me just explain how that would work. If you owned a dry cleaner or a hardware store or any business at all, or a law firm like I have, what you do is you deduct your mortgage payments or your lease payments or your salaries and your other business expenses, and then you only pay tax on what you haven't deducted. In my client's business, he can't do that. He pays taxes on the full amount of his revenue. There are a few exceptions for cost of goods sold, very minor exceptions. So by contrast to every other business in the state, a medical marijuana business pays a huge, enormous amount of taxes. So maybe you already know where I'm going with this, about my opinion about why the federal government is not going to enforce this. I'll tell you in a little bit, the Department of Health Services published statistics for 2014. And they estimate, based on their record keeping, that there was approximately $110 million of medical marijuana sold in Arizona in 2014. So, if you apply the 38% tax rate, which I think is reasonable under these circumstances, to that $110 million, and you realize that those businesses cannot deduct any of their expenses like all of you can, that means that last year, about $42 million went to Washington, D.C. on the sales of medical marijuana in Arizona. So if you're like me and you think that Washington politicians really love money, and you're skeptical like me, you might think that federal lawmakers are probably not going to change anything. I think they like the situation the way it is. It's illegal, right, under the Controlled Substances Act, so that means under the Internal Revenue Code, people like my client can't deduct any of their business expenses whatsoever, so they pay huge amounts of taxes. And on the other hand, they don't have to spend money on the legal medical program because they're defunding law enforcement. So they're getting $42 million just from Arizona alone. And remember, there's 24 states now, 23 or 24 states. So if you add that all up, that's a lot of money going to Washington, D.C. based on medical marijuana. So okay. No one has said this. I have the opinion they're not going to change that. Okay. That's just not going to change. That has to do with my opinion of Washington, D.C. politicians, because I think they just like money, and you're not going to get in the way of their money. But something important to think about when you're thinking about federal regulations.
Could I break in and ask a question?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, go right.
Is that okay? Ahead. Okay. And I hope this isn't off topic, but it might help clarify a question that I have, because if you bring in the fact that they're not allowed to make deductions, are they able to verify employment?
To verify employment, in other words?
Yeah, because generally, you know, as business owners, we show those employees as part of our deduction process. Since there is no deduction, you know, there is no deduction, no itemization, I would presume. Do they have any accountability for their employees?
Yes, absolutely. They file, and that's a good question.
Okay.
I'll talk about that.
Yeah, and if you're going to go there with that somewhere else, then
on that specific point. I'll talk about that specific point right now. They file a regular federal income tax return just like any business. So they list, they have line items for salaries and all of their business expenses, rent or mortgage, whatever their business expenses are. It looks like a normal tax return for a not-for-profit company, okay? Now, by the way, let me just stress, they're not tax-exempt not-for-profits, okay? So you have both kinds of not-for-profit companies. There are tax-exempt not-for-profits that don't have to pay taxes, and then you have not-for-profits that just are not-for-profit, meaning you can't, as an owner, make a profit on the company, on its revenues. But they still pay taxes. So every medical marijuana business, even though it's not for profit, still files a tax return, and they still all file taxes and pay taxes. And one of the things I'll get to in a minute, they have to keep their books according to generally accepted accounting principles, or GAAP. And every year, as a condition of getting their dispensary registration certificate renewed, they have to have their books and records audited, but a true audit by an outside certified public accounting firm that certifies independence and signs off on a true audit. So there are some very significant financial oversights if you're within the program.
Excuse me for a second, Mr. Conant. I know you have a full presentation, and these are based on questions and comments that have been brought up at P&Z, so I don't want you to skip any of them, but we have to keep...
I'll be mindful of the time.
Okay, thank you.
I tend to get going, so like I said, you can stop me and redirect me at any time.
Well, these folks here, I'm sure, are many of them that have made those comments and had those questions. So we need to answer them for their sake, but if we can.
Yes, and I'll just say, after the meeting's over, I'll stay here if people want to talk to me after the meeting. I'll even talk to people after the meeting if anybody's here and they want to talk to me. So
excellent. Thank you.
State law is fairly stringent with respect to what is allowed in the program, and I want to talk about that. I'm going to go through these slides fairly quickly because I think some of this has been covered in the past. But just the fact that you have a medical marijuana card or you're involved in medical marijuana doesn't immunize you from the normal laws of the state of Arizona. So you can be liable for negligence if you're under the influence of medical marijuana. You can be liable for professional malpractice. You can't possess it on a school bus, on the grounds of a school or any correctional facility. You cannot smoke in public. You cannot smoke in public transportation. You can be liable for a DUI if a marijuana, so-called marijuana DUI. Our Arizona Supreme Court has announced law on this. If you're operating a motor vehicle, aircraft, or motorboat, that's all found in the statute. Also, it's medical marijuana, but insurers do not need to reimburse you if you choose to be a medical marijuana user. So it's not impacting your insurance premiums. This is an important one. Any person lawfully in possession of property may prohibit medical marijuana use on property. Mm-hmm. So let me give you an example. If you owned an apartment complex and you wanted to rent out those apartments to people, you could put in the lease, you may not use marijuana here, even medical marijuana, and if you do, it's a violation of your lease and you'll be evicted, okay? So, and that happens. Employers can prohibit ingestion in the workplace. Again, these are the state laws and regulations. I'll try to go through these. Sometimes people are concerned about, well, what kind of a business is this? Is this a gray area business? What sort of people are in the business? In order to get a dispensary agent card as a caregiver or anybody associated with the business, you have to go through a state or federal background check. There's fingerprinting requirements. The fingerprinting data is exchanged with the Federal Bureau of Investigation. It is not a business that attracts people that have a troubled legal past. And again, for the reasons that I stated and others that I'll touch on, somebody like my client would never hire somebody who was a sketchy person or had a troubled legal past. They would never do it because it would jeopardize their entire capital investment, everything that they're trying to do in this business. We'll talk briefly about patients. Patients also have to provide a whole bunch of information, and I've just summarized it there. You can find it in the regulations. Arizona Administrative Code is the AAC, but you have to provide a whole bunch of information to the Department of Health Services in order to get one of those patient cards. So they're not just sort of handing them out, to anybody who just says, "Can I have a patient card?" Principal officers and board members must also have a history of no excluded felony offenses. They have to go through a criminal background check. The fingerprint technician has to sign off on the fingerprint card. So for those of the people in the audience that are in law enforcement, they know that there's a chain of custody procedure. It's all vetted appropriately. The criminal background check requires you to submit all sorts of identification, personal identification information so that you can be traced, tracked. They can make a decision if you're going to get your card, if you're not going to get your card. The regulations continue. Sometimes people have questions about security and what are the security measures that are in place? How is this being handled? Physical security. Medical marijuana must be kept in an enclosed locked facility, and it's only accessible by people who have the cards. So For instance, I invited some of the members of the Planning and Zoning Commission to go to my client's facility, and I said, you can go, but you have to be in the presence, you have to be escorted by somebody with a card, and you also have to be okay with being on high-definition video camera, because as you'll see in a minute, almost every inch, except for the bathrooms, almost every inch of the place has high-definition video cameras, so you can see what's going on. Transportation security. Sometimes people say, well, you know, what's happening? How are they getting it from the grow facility to the dispensary? For instance, the dispensary here in town, just I drove by it when I was coming in. My understanding from listening to some of the comments, there was a fellow associated with that dispensary, and he said that their cultivation facility is in Prescott Valley. I heard him say that at one of the meetings. So Department of Health Services lets you have two facilities. One is a dispensary, and the other is a grow facility. The dispensary has to at least start in your CHA that you're assigned by the state, but your grow facility can be anywhere in the state. Mm. So if you're wondering why are there so many people wanting to put grow facilities here, they're permitted to do so, and they must think the climate is good here or, you know, other reasons. So transportation security, you have to have a trip plan before you go. You have to say who's on the trip, what's on the trip. The medical marijuana cannot be visible in the vehicle. The vehicles must be unmarked. So if there was a car going down the highway, you would never know, which is, you know, that's how they want it. Security measures for a cultivation facility, which is what my client operates here. Let me talk about that for just a minute. They have to have unauthorized intrusion detection equipment. I'm sorry, I misspelled intrusion. I apologize. There has to be lighting, electronic monitoring. It's very detailed technical requirements so that it can be audited by the Department of Health Services. The video cameras in the grow rooms have to be capable of operating in low light conditions. All the video recordings have to be stored for 30 days. There's a battery backup in the case of a power failure, panic buttons, written procedures. So it's very quiet there. Plants are just sort of quietly growing. But if you went there, you're subject to a lot of scrutiny by the security system. How do the businesses operate? I mentioned before, financial statements have to be prepared according to generally accepted accounting principles. These are the same accounting rules that apply to large publicly held companies. It's a very stringent requirement. Additionally, as I mentioned, audits, true audits by an independent outside third-party CPA firm are required. There are three main medical marijuana business functions. One is the dispensary that you've heard about, which is a retail facility. If you're a patient, you could walk in, show your card, get admitted to the facility, and make a purchase within your limit, and then leave. The cultivation is the farm where the product is grown, and if you want to come to my client's facility, we'll arrange a tour. Generally speaking, that offer is open to anybody. It is like farming. It's like gardening. It's heavy work. When they're doing a harvest, it's heavy, backbreaking work. And they have a lot of temporary workers that will come in. They all have to have the same requirements, fingerprinting, et cetera. Hmm. They've got about 20 employees, about 10 full-time, about 10 part-time at my client. Then there's a third business function, which is called infusion, and it's just the kitchen. It's better to just say kitchen because infusion sounds a little weird, I think. But the kitchen is where you take the oil from the plant and you put it into products. And I'll pause briefly on this. Some people that are taking medical marijuana use it because it helps calm nausea. If they have a disease or they're taking medicine that creates nausea, medical marijuana helps with that. They can use the medical marijuana and then they can eat, keep their food down and keep their nutrition up. Those people can't obviously eat an edible. They typically will smoke the marijuana because that it doesn't, you're not trying to keep something down if you're smoking. A lot of people don't want to smoke, however, because it's unhealthy for your lungs. So they prefer the edibles. And these edibles are brownies, cookies, Rice Krispie treats, and things like that. Yeah. They don't look like the old Cheech and Chong movie brownies with twigs and leaves and things like that sticking out of them, right. Because it's the oil that's used. So if you can imagine a brownie mix where you have to put a vegetable oil and some marijuana oil and a couple of eggs and, you know, mix it up. It's just oil that's going into it. So anyway, that might be helpful to know. Other people are wondering, well, you know, why is there so much cultivation here in Chino Valley? Because we can't have that many medical marijuana users here. All of the medical marijuana that my client grows is leaving Chino Valley. Mm-hmm. It doesn't stay here. It has to leave. It's required to leave. Most cardholders are in, oh, my last slide didn't show up there. Well, if I could, there was a chart in there, and the slide said most medical marijuana users are in Phoenix and Tucson, mm-hmm. the population centers. And so if you could see that chart, you'd see it's published on the DHS, Department of Health Services website. They track all those statistics. And it's like these charts that you've seen where the more densely populated areas have darker colors and so forth. This is a very lightly colored area. There really aren't that many people here that have medical marijuana cards. The medical marijuana that's being grown here by my client is going to Green Valley, south of Tucson. Okay, so I don't know where the others are going, but it's not staying here. And remember, they don't want it to stay here because they can't let it stay here under the rules. You might be interested to know that in the month of October 2015, according to DHS, in the state of Arizona, there were 3,900 pounds of medical marijuana sold statewide. It's a significant number. It is up from 2014 because there are more cardholders than there were in 2014. There are 84,242 qualifying patients statewide. Very large number. Thursday night football, the Cardinals are playing tonight. I don't think their stadium has 84,000 people in it. So large number of people.
Mr. Conant, is there any chance that we could get a copy of the slide presentation? I don't want to
yes, sir.
Use any proprietary stuff.
But yes, sir.
I'm writing these numbers down as fast as I can.
Yes, so. Sir. I have... yes, sir. We'll get you a copy of that.
Cool. Thank you.
Hopefully tonight. I have a disc, and I can hopefully get it to you tonight.
No big hurry.
You might be curious to know that in the Chino Valley Ash Fork CHA, which is your CHA, DHS reports there are only 593 card-holding patients. So if you look at the Chino Valley Ash Fork CHA, it's actually a pretty large geographic area. Mm-hmm. You've only got 593 patients here. Again, the medical marijuana being grown here is not staying here. Okay, you would not have pounds and pounds and pounds and pounds of marijuana for 593 people. I mentioned this before. DHS estimate is $110 million was spent on medical marijuana in Arizona. This would be my guess, just based on watching the figures as they're reported on a monthly basis by DHS. That probably isn't going to quite double for 2015, but because of the increase in patient cards to this 84,000 patient number, it's probably going to be $150 to $200 million. So if you hearken back to my point about what's going to the federal government, that means that there may be $80 million in taxes paid by people like my client to Washington. And this is my last slide, the summary. By statute in the state, it's legal in Arizona, but it's regulated by the Department of Health Services. I try to give you some idea about what the parameters of that are. That's nothing that you could do anything about. You know, I respect the fact that your constituents may be saying to you, you know, you have to do something differently, we want something done differently, but your town council, you don't have the power to override that statute, but I wanted you at least get the feel for what does the state statute apply so that people understand there is somebody paying attention. Department of Health Service is paying attention. It's their job to do that. On the federal part of it, I know it's confusing for a lot of people. Why is it legal but not legal? But you know, why is it like that? Hopefully I've given you a flavor, for at least for why I think it is, and I think it has to do with the money, the age-old saying, follow the money. If $80 million goes for medical marijuana to Washington, D.C. for 2015, do you really think they're going to change the way things are? My opinion is no, they won't. And then the local part of it is what we're talking about, and that's where I want to try to redirect it back to what I know this study session really is about, and that's the reasonable zoning regulations. You do have power under the Arizona Medical Marijuana Act to make reasonable zoning regulations, and my colleague, Ralph Pugh, is here. That's the other presentation that we asked to make. Ralph is a very experienced, talented land use lawyer, and I asked him to get involved to try to help to make some suggestions because, like I said, my client is a part and wants to continue to be a part of the community, wants to integrate into the community, wants to stay low-key and has been low-key for 2 years, really, just doing their business. And we know that your constituents want you to do something about this, and I guess it's probably even okay with my client, too, Ted, that you have fewer growers here in the future. There's no reason why they would object to that. They want to be here, but they're not looking to have others come necessarily. Mr. Pugh can explain this, but there are a few ways that we've thought about that, at least for those who are already here, particularly those in the circle, like my client is in the circle that Ms. Mayday showed. For those that are already here, there are ways to avoid that problem of the expense, but risk of the expense of somebody making a claim for money. And I'll let him explain it, but we were at the Planning and Zoning Commission meeting, and we asked to make a presentation briefly then about those two things. The commission thought enough of it to send those up to you, and that's why we asked for permission to make this presentation today. So I know I took a lot of time. I apologize for that, but hopefully this was helpful. Thank you.
No sweat. Like I said, those are questions many of our audience members have asked. A lot of those statements I've heard, so thank you for clarifying those.
And I've got more, so I'll be here, after the meeting, if anybody wants to speak with me. Okay, thank you. I don't know if there's questions.
Did we have any other questions from council for Mr. Clement? None? Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
One question. Employment.
Yes, sir.
That you touched on, that you generally have 10 full-time and occasionally 10 part-time during harvest.
Yes, during the harvest, exactly. So the harvest is it's really hard, backbreaking work. It's something that's very good for younger people to do, basically. So temporary people are brought in, and there are about 10 temporary people that are qualified, have gone through the fingerprinting and have the cards, and they'll come in at the harvests to do that work.
Okay, so wages for that type of help?
Let me ask for sure, but they're pretty good. You're talking about the temporary or the permanent? I can get
both.
I'll get you both. Can you tell me, Al?
Yeah, our
So I don't know if that made it into the record, but it was $13 an hour for the part-time, and yes, the salaried people go, up to a six-figure for the head person, head grower, and they get benefits.
Okay. Excellent. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
And it was, Miss, what was the other fellow's name that was had the other half of the presentation?
Mr. Pugh. Ralph Pugh is here. He's the other one we asked for him
okay.
to be able to
yes, sir.
Presentation.
You bet.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. My name is Ralph Pugh. I live in the town of Gilbert, and my office is in the city of Mesa. It's a pleasure to be with you this evening, and my thoughts and ideas will not be as comprehensive as my colleague, Mr. Conant, who understands this industry thoroughly. You're here tonight to deal with a land use issue.
Yes,
somehow my practice of law has been doing that for 36 years. It's a strange, interesting area, but fun. So what's facing you tonight is the discussion with your citizens here on items to consider in an amendment to the UDO, which is contains your zoning ordinance. And that amendment effectively modifies your zoning ordinance that was adopted in 2013. Right. So here in 2010, marijuana is made legal. 2011, it becomes effective. You as a town, probably your predecessors, maybe some of you adopted a reasonable ordinance in 2013, and in that ordinance, the cultivation of medical marijuana was allowed in certain zoning districts as permitted, and it required a use permit in other districts. And you are now considering amendments to that to further regulate and restrict the manner and placement of medical marijuana in your community. Many times we think that the only answer to this dilemma is to either shut down the industry completely and make a very drastic change to your ordinance, or continue the way you are. Mm-hmm. There is middle ground, and the two ideas I would like to present to you tonight offer that opportunity. As you deliberate this ordinance tonight and the factors and the options that your staff has mentioned, you can also keep in the back of your mind that there are two tools that state statute specifically allows towns and cities to use to, in essence, allow a property owner to have the security and assurance that their use can continue and can have some reasonable expansion, and at the same time, define for the municipality the parameters of that expansion and the standards of it, and more importantly, for your interests, a release and a waiver of any potential claim under Prop 207, which I'm sure you know about. I don't want to bore you with that. So the first thing you could do as you deliberate this, you could ask your staff to work, and I'm here with Mr. Conant as his colleague on behalf of Mr. Abrams, you could instruct them to work with us to create what's known as a development agreement. You may have used those in your community in the past, I don't know. But development agreements are specifically authorized by state law so that a town and city can enter into, in essence, a contract with a property owner, and that contract governs the uses and the intensity of those uses on a piece of property. And it can also address the release of potential claims by your adoption of this new ordinance. You could then decide to allow those negotiations to occur. We bring to you ultimately a draft of that agreement. And it would, for any particular grower who is growing medical marijuana legally today, it would allow that property owner to define the extent to which expansion of that use could occur in the zoning district where it is allowed today. And that would be a development agreement. It would have a site plan. It would show the roads, the access points, the utility, all the fire safety, everything that goes with a site plan you would typically see in a development project in your community. The second tool that's allowed by state statute, towns and cities are specifically authorized to approve site plans or development plans. You've all seen them as projects come to your community. You see the building and the parking and the landscape and all of that. You can take a site plan. For example, if Mr. Abrams decided to present to you a site plan that showed some expansion on his site, you could then, at his request, make a decision to designate or denominate that site plan as a protected development right plan. That's a term of art under state statute, and that would allow that plan to be protected from further zoning changes that would change the use to which the owner can use his land today. And typically, the statute says the time period for that is 3 years when it's a non-phased project and 5 years if it's phased. You then have the leeway to consider a 2-year extension based on all of the circumstances at that time. So in essence, that site plan map would turn into this protected plan. And we would propose to you that if you suggest that and direct your staff ultimately as you go through these study sessions and consider this to do that, we would be willing and happy to cooperate and enter into either one of those type of arrangements with the town so that we all can do two things, and this is the words the statute uses. In the Protected Development Right Plan statute, it uses the language that says, such a protected development right will preserve fairness and stability in land use regulations for the town, and at the same time, promote economic investment reliance by the property owner. Those are the two issues to balance here. Because as Mr. Conant said, cultivating medical marijuana is an extremely expensive endeavor. And those who do it do not want to violate the law. They want to do it circumspectly and correctly. And they would be very interested in considering with the town either one of those agreements. And for the town's benefit, it would define the extent of expansion rights, the utilities that need to be brought in, the safety protections, all those things, and would release the town from any potential 207 claim. And we're certainly not here tonight to debate that, because there's a lot of opinions on the 207 claims, and it's a lot of uncertainty out there. We're trying to bring stability to that. Put the grower in a box for expansion, release the town, move forward with your ordinance in any other respect. Mr. Mayor, you've been very patient, and council members listening to me. Councilmember Miller, I do like the term grandfathered rights, because those of us that are grandfathers like that term, don't we? But unfortunately, Ms. Mayday is absolutely correct in the terminology. So there you go. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have, council members.
Right. Any questions on this side? Any questions?
Yeah,
on this
can
side?
We yes, can sir. We possibly get what you were telling us in writing?
Yes, you can. So I did have a PowerPoint presentation that highlights the sections of the code.
That'd be awesome.
And we can also provide this in writing from the clerk's office eventually.
Excellent. That's thank you.
Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you.
That's why we're here tonight, is to get information. We've got a lot of stuff.
You got a lot of public input coming. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. We will now go to our public input. As I said, we're not here to debate the legality or the morality. What? A break.
Make sure you're looking at him and not me.
All right. I wonder, Jan is in the sound room. Jan, could you come out and visit with us? Miss Maisie? Okay. Okay. I know we're supposed to break at 8 o'clock, so you can swap the recording disc. Would it be okay to do it now, or we can take a short break now and then?
Good, but if it goes past 9:30, then we have to do it again.
If we go past 9:30, most of these guys will go home anyway. So. Okay, great. How about I'll just take the break now, and you can swap the discs. Okay, great.
10 minutes is all I need.
Okay, we will now have a 10-minute break.
God bless you, son. You're
welcome, Corey. I wonder who wanted to break.
So what's the score?
Where are you going, Corey?
Well, I haven't looked. I was figuring doing numbers on his presentation.
What those old guys couldn't control? Yeah.
I'll look right now.
Doing well down there. It's nice having clean neighbors, well, as far as that goes.
Hi, how are you? We're just trying to make the real smiley face or the fake one?
This is the fake one.
Oh, I see the leader.
It's not hard to tell.
Are you ready to be home like the rest of you? You know what? This is the last one of the year.
We're
really putting it to them this month, boys.
We didn't even think about it.
We're getting double paid. And last month.
Oh, yeah. Did you ever do anything in the commercial department as far as for a means to do commercial?
As in building? There one interesting thing. So you know, from the builder side, it's just a
what I thought was going to do your bathroom and stuff. What happened? It hasn't been done yet.
Are you mad at it?
No, it just hasn't been done yet.
You said you were going to call me. You're ready, right? I wasn't supposed to just come do it.
Oh, that would work too. Then you could just surprise me. Next week, I still got to get my fence up. Did you need something?
Yeah, this is my neighbor. We're trying to get together as a group and talk to all of us so that we aren't convinced and not bring up one after another saying the same thing. That's what all the waste of time. And that was the
I'm right next to the vineyard.
make a bunch of stuff. I'll see if I can get a six.
No.
Is that the share side?
This is the share side.
Or so we're missing a couple of our council members. All right. Is Mr. Best back there? Okay. Just about zoning. That's all we need. That's all we're going to address.
Okay.
I'm going to reiterate.
Yeah, you need to, because it's going to go nuts.
Okay, if everybody would please grab a seat. Okay, we're back in session. I'm going to reiterate part of my introduction because I want us to stay focused. Tonight's study session is on zoning ordinances affecting medical marijuana growing facilities. As I said earlier, I realize it's an emotional subject. We're here to conduct the town business. I ask that everyone be respectful to one another. Please keep your comments to 3 minutes. There was a gentleman that came up earlier that's going to be speaking for several different folks, asked if he could have 6 minutes, and I'm okay with that. I would ask you, please, no repetitive stuff. We have had probably altogether, I would say, 6-8 hours between planning and zoning and the town council meetings dealing with the medical marijuana issue. Like I said, it's emotional. I don't want folks talking about it's immoral or it's illegal or it's this, that, or the other. We need to be dealing with the zoning ordinances themselves. For those who are morally opposed to the medical marijuana, the subject of medical marijuana itself, Mr. Chad Nanke is in the back row. Mr. Nanke, could you please raise your hand? He and I spoke several weeks back, and I gave him contact info for launching an initiative to repeal medical marijuana in Arizona. He's concerned about, rather than dealing with the grows themselves, he wants to put it back before the public. And that's the great thing about America. We're allowed to do that. And so please see Mr. Nanke if that's one of your concerns. Like I said, we're not here to talk about the moral or the legal aspects. We're here to talk about the zoning. All right, the chair will entertain the first person who wishes to speak. Yes, sir? You were already up there.
I was ready to roll.
Okay, yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Eric Culberson. I am currently the head of cultivation for our Chino site. I am a consultant to all of our other sites around the U.S. I have a bachelor's degree in biology from Arizona State University, mm-hmm. and I'm a graduate nurse finishing at the top of my class.
Mm-hmm.
For the last 10 years, I've specialized in the scientific process. I've been employed by the world's largest pharmaceutical companies, where they trusted me and my team to explore the safety and the efficacy of many of the drugs that y'all take on a daily basis. These true drugs, as I call them, are concoctions made up of many different chemicals, including petroleum products. Often these chemical mixtures are created to mimic a botanical molecule. In short, these drugs are created to mimic plants and the actions that plants have. That's what we study in the scientific community, to find drugs of interest that help with our cholesterol, our blood pressure, anything and everything. I saw firsthand the detrimental effects that these drugs can have on us, things that the governing bodies, such as the FDA and the USDA, overlook because it only affected a portion of the population studied. My reason for speaking to you isn't to scare you from your pharmaceuticals. It's simple. I'm here to ask for everybody here, I wanted to speak about the safety of this plant and the absolute immediate need for education. We're spending a lot of time talking about planning and zoning, but the larger issue at hand that I hear overwhelmingly is the safety for those in our community. We're at a large crossroads in our nation, and we have the eventual nationwide legalization of cannabis on the horizon. It's merging lanes onto the highway of majestic American prosperity. We need to focus our efforts not to spite those who think differently, but to promote the moral and ethical development of our community, starting with our youngsters. We're all born with a drive to explore our emotions, our strengths, our curiosity, and our imagination, but we need to focus on building the youth.
Excuse me, Mr. Culverson.
Sure.
We're sort of easing away from the zoning part of it, but I did want to give you a little bit of leeway because you haven't spoken at, you're one of the few faces that's not familiar. but if you would, you're sort of learning now. Okay.
The main focus now is we need to not worry about how far reaching this plant can go. If you restrict the grow sites here in Chino Valley, cannabis is wide reaching in its distribution. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Trying to eradicate it by minimizing exposure to our youth and our community through planning and zoning ordinances is not only a detriment to our youth, but it really slows our economic growth in a small town that needs it. So I'll leave you with that. Okay. If y'all have any medical questions, I'm happy to answer them.
You bet. And that's Mr. Culverson.
Culberson.
Culberson. Okay. Correct. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Culberson. Okay. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is David Albus, and I'm a resident here of Chino Valley, mm-hmm. and I've spoken before. And first off, I want to say thank you for that presentation, and I'll follow on it. You know, you did a great job of defining our current federal corruption. And things are really messed up. And I know you don't want to talk about the morality, but you can. That's an aspect we have to consider. And for this, mm-hmm. now with the concept of medical marijuana, mm-hmm. if it was what I call a true medical setup, yeah, I don't mind the idea if they could put it in a pill or put it in a vaporizer. But when you're putting it in cookies and brownies that little kids can get a hold of, and it encourages youth, you know, look at cigarettes. We stopped selling cigarette gum, you know.
Mr. Mayor, I think you need to stop this.
Yes, sir.
We're talking about zoning
I'll,
here.
I'll go. I'll get
We've all been through. I understand the problems with youth. I was a drug counselor and worked mm-hmm. that I've done before. Whether I'm for or against drugs, that's a separate issue than we have here tonight.
Okay,
when I vote somewhere along the line, then my personal likes and dislikes will come out.
Okay. Please shorten it up, Mr. Albus, and then I will caution our audience once again. Yes, sir.
Okay. Basically, it boils down to history shows our future. There's other aspects to this we have to consider. We've seen how Colorado and Washington have legalized it just across the board and outside of medical, and we can look at them to see our future. Do we want to promote that or do we not? And okay. That's basically what it boils down to.
Cool. Thank you, sir. Once again, we've had numerous hours of testimony from our public regarding whether they felt it should be legalized, whether they felt it should be illegal. We've I'm sure planning and zoning, Miss Mayday, have you heard one or two things on the moral and the legal aspects of it? Okay. Tonight we're dealing with the zoning issue alone, okay? Any others for ma'am in the back?
Hi, good evening. I know I've spoken before.
It's Lillian Morales, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
It's terrible when people actually know your name.
I know the feeling. Yes,
I'm not going to go into what I did before because it's a matter of record and anyone that wants to listen to it can. But I was reading in the newspaper Wednesday on the Wednesday paper all the list of the proposals made by Planning and Zoning and the two proposals, I guess, made by the growers. So in reading those, you know, they seem to be pretty good proposals by Planning and Zoning to at least try to limit the number of growers here in Chino Valley. And I liked the presentation by the attorney, very informative. However, very long, and, you know, at my age, my brain is like a sieve.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
But I did enjoy the presentation into the legalities of this. And if you guys are going to consider one of their proposals, then if you make a contract with them, in my opinion, you need to make certain that contract is airtight, that it cannot be turned around at any point in time, that it cannot be extended at any point in time, and that it's truly a legal contract and an airtight contract. Because if not, we're going to end up in the same quagmire that we're in right now.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so that's it.
Thank you. All right. And I know Ms. Mayday hates the word grandfathered use, but we've... what was the legal term on that?
Legal nonconforming.
Grandfathered. All right. Yeah, grandfather, it's fine. I think this lady was next in the red, and then I'm going to pick some folks on the right-hand side here. Yes, ma'am.
Just two short things. One was a security concern. If there is going to be a nursery at the roundabout and there was an unmarked car coming to that location, I don't know when they'd pick it up at night, I would be concerned about security of hijacking that vehicle and running off. It's at the very entrance of town that happens. I spent time with the Transportation Security Administration as a federal officer, and things happen that you never expect. The other concern, and it's just a short one, on the very good presentation about the federal government reaping in so many tax incentives, I worry not about the pain relief, which is good for people that might need that for a short time, but it destroys the brain cells. And then after 5 years of use, where does that life go if they're not into hospice, okay, rather than research for something more productive? That's just
Thank you, ma'am. Could I have your name, ma'am?
Laura Flood.
Laura Flood, okay. And as I said earlier, we've addressed in previous meetings the medical benefits or non-benefits, the moral stuff. Over on this side, do we have any? Yes, sir. And please state your name.
My name's Jim Runner, and I live at 330 South Mountain View. I guess mine's more of in the form of a question. Every sentence that's been spoken of is medical marijuana. What happens if by next year it becomes legal for recreational use? Do we start all over again? He's talking about pounds of pot sitting there not being utilized. It's not like that. Well, would it fall into that category then?
Okay. I believe if we do enact an ordinance, and Ms. Smiley, please correct me on this, but I believe if we do enact an ordinance, it will be for marijuana growing facilities. We will probably have to make it a little bit broader rather than just MMJ.
Okay,
and that's one of the concerns that folks in the community have, but we're not gonna wander off into whether that should happen or not. Thank you. Okay, the grow facilities.
So, to be clear, this only pertains to the medical marijuana. So if it should become recreational, there could be a distinction
between the grows that we're dealing with now are exclusive medical.
That's correct. That's correct. And one of the principles of zoning is that if a use is not permitted in your zoning code, and I don't know if your zoning code is actually written this way, but often zoning codes are written that if a use is not specifically permitted, it's prohibited. So if it's not. Okay, so that might be something that we'll consider down the road if it looks like recreational marijuana is going to come to fruition. It's hard to say at this point in time because we don't know if there is actually going to be an initiative on the ballot. If you go to the Secretary of State's website, I believe there are 14 petitions that are circulating to allow recreational marijuana. I don't know if any of those will actually make it through the process or not. And once they do, will they be on the ballot? I don't know. So it's hard to say, but the one that you're considering now and what's in your zoning code now only applies to medical marijuana. And that's as that term is defined, I believe, in the Medical Marijuana Act. So it's very restrictive.
So if they didn't want to to change the purpose of their grow, they would have to come back through the system again.
Yes.
I've made myself a note. We'll be speaking with staff on that because we need to have that nailed down, okay? Thank you. Next. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, my sister and I both are here, but we are the daughters of Billy and Betty Wells, who are prominent members of this area. And I think restriction definitely is very good, but something that's not been mentioned here tonight that definitely should be considered is water use. We need to definitely look hard at that because water is a big deal.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to just briefly address that here in Arizona. We have water use that goes with the land. I have had a concerned citizen that has been asking me about water use, and I said, strikingly enough, I've been attempting to grow corn, and ADWR is taking our water away from us. I don't want to start on that subject tonight, but that ranks right up there with federal government and their taxes. But thank you. And your name, ma'am, you said Billy Wells' daughter. I couldn't.
I'm sorry.
Oh. Okay.
No.
Okay. Thank you. Over here. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Carla Acosta, and I am a property owner here. It might be small, but it is mine. Both tonight and also on December 1st, I heard Mr. Albrim's attorneys keep bringing up Prop 207. Now, I believe in 2006, when we passed Prop 207, it was to protect us as property owners, and they keep throwing this up there. So does this mean if they can use this now, okay, this way, 2006, I'm sorry, Prop 207. So now the marijuana stuff all came in 2010. Now we're here at 2015 arguing over something that we never would have dreamt of 20 years ago, okay? And they're using Prop 207. Mm-hmm. So as a property owner, little old me, does that mean 5-10 years from now, when my property value has plummeted because we have become the pot capital of Arizona, does that mean I can use Prop 207 against whatever? Because as a property owner, that bill was to protect us, not to be thrown in our face.
Right. Okay.
And also, and no disrespect to Mr. Abrams. Mm-hmm. No disrespect to this man's, honestly, but we keep referring to his property as a KOA property, which I'm assuming this was the land that we were selling for the KOA RV park out of Vegas, and then it fell through.
There's a lot to that, but go ahead. But he's just stating that to show you the location.
I know, but see, when we were doing that, he had no intentions on farming this land. Now all of a sudden, he's a farmer, and it is a big deal to him. And honestly, no disrespect to him, but I am also a property owner that is very concerned with 5-10 years down the road, when no respectable citizen wants to move to Chino Valley because we are the pot capital of Arizona.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, appreciate that. Just a little brief clarification, because I've still, all these years later, I'm hearing about the KOA campground. Had folks tell me that the town killed the KOA. No, the town did not. The KOA wanted to come in, wanted to do certain things, and they didn't have the financing to do it, and that's the way it is. The reference was simply to show folks where it was located, and it's now a different owner. Okay. As was brought up earlier, we have good climate here. This has always been farming country, and so folks have asked us, as I said earlier, they've asked us to look into what we can do to limit the number of marijuana grows here. That's why we're here tonight, to talk about that. Others? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Cindy Lazo, and I'm a homeowner here at 2184 East Cyrus Drive in Bright Star. And I like the presentation that was given, but I can see very little benefit to our town financially for these growing operations to be in existence. Mm-hmm. The product is shipped out. It seems like very little financial gain is to be had to have them in our town. Mm-hmm. And I am opposed to enlarging them, or I would like to see more restrictions.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. And that was Lazo, Cindy Lazo? Okay, thank you. Others? On zoning. Yes, sir. Guy looks familiar.
Yes. Mr. Mayor, council members, I'm John Morgan, I'm a 27-year resident here in Chino Valley, and my entire time in education. I had something different prepared to say tonight, but since we're focusing on trying to stay germane with zoning, a couple of suggestions on the zoning part of it. One is, I think some of this, you have what you have, which we all know, and some wish to grow in the business here. There's some abatement things you can do, because what we've heard from some of the residents is they don't like the smell, and I can concur with that. I drive in the morning, I ride my motorcycle, and I can smell the one on 4 North. There's no doubt about it. But these companies have abatement techniques that they can use to eradicate some of that, and I think you need to look at that a little bit here. The second thing is when it comes to zoning, since my background has been in ag, most of my life I've been in agriculture, I can tell you that right now I consult heavily with people that are in the wine industry. It seems to me like a lot of folks don't have any problem with that. We have vineyards that are growing here. We have new ones that have emerged in the last few years. The wine industry in the Yavapai County is one of the fastest growing industries in this county. But I would suggest to you, when it comes to zoning, is if you want to compare apples to apples here, wine is someone else's drug of choice, mm-hmm. correct? Mm-hmm. I don't see this kind of a turnout to viticulture growers from a zoning standpoint. Mm. I guess I'm trying to understand here if someone can really explain to me the difference, because personally, as a lifelong educator, I don't see it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Mr. Mayor?
Would it be possible for me to break in? I guess I was just kind of hoping for a little bit different from the call to the public. Is it appropriate for me to say something?
Yes.
Yes. No, sorry. You know, I was excited to see growers here tonight. I'm not a fan of marijuana, but I am a fan of farming. I've farmed for many, many years, and my husband is a third-generation farmer from the Midwest. And I was really hoping that we could try to hit a middle ground by our town embracing the farming aspect of this, since we are talking about cultivation. Mm-hmm. We have a very small distribution center. I doubt that, you know, the whole town even knows where it is. But the farming is right, there's one right around the corner from me. It's very well landscaped, very secured. I don't think anybody even knew what it was. And I think that if we can meet a middle ground without knowing what the outcome is going to be tonight and without mm-hmm. going there, just I was really hoping that maybe the farmers, the growers, could speak a little more to maybe educate the people here, not on what the moral issues are on this, right. but on it as a, because we are talking cultivation. Because although we're looking at zoning and regulation, we are also looking at it from the aspect of farming, and that's what our community has always been and always embraced. Mm-hmm. Is this any different than a GMO corn that maybe we don't like, or tobacco, mm-hmm. or the vineyards that Mr. Morgan mentioned? I'm not making a decision for you. I'm just saying maybe we should just open our mind a little bit and look at that.
Okay, thank you, thank you. That gives me an idea. As soon as ADWR cuts my water down, I'll start growing tobacco. yes, sir. I believe, Mike, were you going to speak? Or, yes, sir.
If I may, my name's Perry Stone, and we got together. Mike is going to speak for us. But to answer your question, ma'am, we kind of wanted to wait. We sat here and waiting until it was our turn.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so that we could get to the crux of zoning. Cool. And cultivation and the agricultural side of this. That's why we're here.
Okay.
Mike O'Connor, please.
Yes, sir.
My name is Mike O'Connor, and sir. I'm a 20-year resident of Chino, graduate of ASU, and my background is in finance, computers, and agriculture. I've been farming vegetables here in Chino for the last 20 years. Mm. And this is where I hope to retire, and I'm committed to what I think is good for Chino Valley. I attended the last two PNZ meetings and heard a lot of comments. So I rent my land to one of the active grow sites right now. Mm-hmm. So I'll be giving you kind of the boots on the ground perspective. I kind of slashed and burned some of what I was going to say here, and it was actually agricultural related, but now I can barely read some of the stuff I've scratched out because I was trying to keep it exclusively to zoning. So I will expand a little bit on the agricultural aspects of it.
Yes, sir.
No water issues.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
And I'll keep to the narrow issue of the grow sites and whether or not we should restrict the zoning codes, because doing so will somehow keep the town safer and more drug-free. This is what I heard an awful lot over and over in the last two PNZ meetings. To start with, cannabis grow sites are horticulture or agricultural sites. From a zoning perspective, they look just like any other hort operation, like Bonnie Farm or Color Spot or V&P Nurseries. It's about growing and harvesting a plant and all the difficulties that come with it. It happens to be a tightly controlled plant, but from the outside, it's just another greenhouse operation. Mm-hmm. No one can see the plants inside the existing greenhouse, so it isn't a visibility issue. Cannabis grow sites are essentially indistinguishable from any other greenhouse operation. One goal of zoning is to manage various land uses that are thought to be incompatible. If no one's concerned about rezoning existing horticulture, why are we focusing on a specific plant within horticulture? Hmm. For starters, it's been suggested that the sites will add to the supply of cannabis in Chino, which will somehow reach our children. For starters, two grow sites have been operating quietly in Chino for the past 2 years already. These grow sites operate just like the other greenhouses in Chino. Bonnie Farm, Color Spot, V&P Nurseries. It is agriculture, except the plant is very tightly regulated. It takes about 12 or more weeks to bring a plant to harvest. Up until that time, it doesn't have much value because the mature flowers are what is actually valuable. Each plant may have only a few ounces of harvestable material, so stealing a bunch of 15-gallon potted plants would entail a lot of work for not much return. And remember, and it's all on camera, remember. At every step from harvest to packing, all materials weighed and accounted for to the tenth of a gram, which is 1/280th of an ounce. We perform monthly internal audits, and the state performs on-site audits twice a year to ensure we're in compliance, and we are. So to address the issue of cannabis somehow spreading out from the cultivation sites to the broader community, it just isn't happening. For traditional horticulture, these sites are small. Color Spot has over 300,000 square feet. Bonnie has about 120,000 square feet of growing area. Scale of efficiency obviously drives this, but profitability in any agricultural venture, including cannabis, is not guaranteed. When dealing with a live plant, nothing is guaranteed. Every farmer knows this. The differences here are that cannabis horticulture uses less water, few of any chemicals, pays better wages to more people per acre, 30 versus 5 people, and brings higher levels of security. If an operation the size of Color Spot were to grow cannabis, it would employ between 200 and 300 workers instead of the current 40, plus a lot of managers. And from the outside, you wouldn't know the difference. Over the years, I've heard council members state they need to attract more retail stores so they can collect sales taxes to pay for city services. The problem with that is that service jobs don't pay very well. I've heard complaints that because grow sites are wholesale and their product doesn't generate sales tax, that the town doesn't benefit economically. It's true that wholesale manufacturers of any product don't pay sales tax, since their products aren't sold at retail on their sites. But what's really important is that first you need good jobs so people have money to spend at retail stores. I've heard people say Safeway has some of the better paying jobs in town. Their courtesy clerks start at $9.12 an hour, and their cashiers at $11.55 an hour. Our site, and I heard Mr. Abrams say, that their workers in ours start at $13 an hour. And there are three supervisors and one facilities manager who make significantly more. They need people who know plant science. Three workers went through the Yavapai College Ag program at Old Hold Manor. The main grower has an RN, a bachelor's in biology, and years of experience in pharmaceutical research. 19 people work at our facility. And SWC made it public that their monthly payroll for Chino Valley is around $55,000 a month.
Excuse me, Mr. O'Connor, you're starting to wind your time down. I know you asked for 6 minutes.
You're right. Okay. I am starting to. The point that I hadn't heard made was that just the two current grow sites are putting in $100,000 a month, every month, in just payroll. And if you're going to restrict the zoning and restrict an industry that really looks and acts for all intents and purposes just like a Color Spot, I don't understand why there's this extreme concern and an emergency session to rapidly make a decision on this industry. Clearly, what I heard in P&Z, a lot of people do not understand this industry well. And so, as Attorney Ralph Pugh noted, it's an extremely expensive endeavor to start a grow site. I'd like the town to get as much of that money as we can. You know, and municipalities around the state are starting to realize they want grow sites. They've started to increase the size of them. They've changed their zoning not to reduce the size of grow sites, but to expand them. And Tucson eliminated any limitation on grow sites whatsoever. Tempe increased their site size from 3,000 to 25,000 square feet, because they found out there is no increase in crime and diffusion of product from the grow sites. So I ask the council to really take their time in making this decision. I'm boots on the ground. I live 30 feet from a grow site. So if there's any impact on zoning because of a grow site, I would be the first one to feel it. So I make myself available for your questions if you need.
Thank you, sir. others regarding, yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Brian McLaren. My background is in sustainable development. So I work with Mr. Abrams at the site in the development construction of the property on the real estate side. So I just wanted to share a few items about the property itself that I think would be helpful, especially on the economic side. Firstly is that when we acquired the property, we paid about $90,000 in back taxes. So that was something that we felt was really important, obviously, to get that up to date. We will pay another $25,000 in property taxes this year. The site itself, hundreds of thousands of dollars were spent locally. So that's a huge part of sustainable development principle, is encouraging the locality itself and getting as close to possible to the site, so not importing materials and not exporting jobs and dollars. So, you know, your local Ace Hardware and other property owners and service providers in town is something that we focus very heavily on. Oh, yes, definitely. Sorry. Helpful. I can repeat if anyone didn't hear that.
You're good.
The other item I wanted to bring up is that I did work directly with the city of Tempe on their recent amendment to the zoning code. So we actually submitted that amendment. It was about an 8-month process, and I really also wanted to make the statement that your local staff here is pretty phenomenal. So we've really appreciated the support of the BNZ department, and that's a really big benefit for us. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, sir. And that was Brian McLaren? Okay, thank you. Okay, others? Yes, sir.
Hi, my name's Andy Erickson. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
What I see is, besides a few select people, the town of Chino Valley, the people here do not want marijuana, medical or recreational. So I'm calling on the town council to do whatever they can to limit it. It's marijuana is not just another plant. I've been involved in agriculture my whole life too, on ranches and stuff. And what we're, it's not about economics, it's about what it does to people, okay? And a coworker of mine at the hospital, he has a rehab house, and he deals with these people that have been affected. Marijuana is a gateway drug. I know,
Mr. Erickson,
but this is why we don't want it. Okay, so I'm calling on you, the council, to do whatever we can to limit.
Yes, please. As I said, we've had a great deal of testimony dealing with the legality, the morality, the drug usage.
That was all I'm going to say about that, but I'm calling on the town council to limit it and represent the will of the people and do what you can. One of the options was to limit the size. Let's make it small. Let's make it hard for these guys. Come on, let's do something to represent the people here. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. I need to remind everybody once again, we're staying with the zoning. Yes, sir.
I can see everybody giving me a dirty look, but
yes, sir.
One thing I would like to do is have you bring back up that map of the city.
While she's doing that, could you give us your name, sir?
The areas. Yeah, that one. Now, there was, can you bring it down a little bit? Oh, there you go. Okay, whoop, back up.
Excuse me, sir. Okay.
This has to do with the zoning.
Okay, first you need to give us your name.
Secondly,
were you looking for the map that only showed where
looking for the whole zoning.
The entire zoning. Map. Okay. Okay. Your name,
okay,
sir?
Well,
John.
I'm John Trout.
Thank you, sir.
And I live in Chino Valley.
Okay.
And I've been before the council a few times.
Yes, sir.
And so that's why they all give me kind of a funny look. So
okay.
Anyway, what I'm interested in is I noticed there's a couple of spots over in the red that are supposedly allowable.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Is that one there off Center Street that goes back west of 89?
This one?
Right. Down. Where's Center Street? It's right down there, I think.
I have to make this bigger to be able to figure it out.
Yeah, that's Perkins.
Where's the high school?
Yeah.
Where's
no, that
high school? It's Perkins. Bills,
yeah. And this is okay, the right there, I think. That little red mark off to the
this
left.
This one. This here or down here?
As you go down and you see that bigger area down there.
North,
right, right there.
Center,
no, that one.
Center is the top of those green blocks.
I don't know.
Well, there's a flower growing plant there.
There used to be, yes.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Well, conceivably, the way it is now, that he could raise marijuana there?
Actually, no. That's one of the...
Okay.
If I could.
I'm sorry.
Actually, no, that is surrounded by residential, so it had to be the 500 feet boundaries would overlap. That actually is one that several growers have approached the town about. There are several properties, and this is one they called about right out of the gate. And because of the 500 feet separation from residential, they can't build any.
Right,
they, it can't be used for that.
Okay, well, and that's something else, too. The one that's proposed down by the roundabout. I understand that that's supposed to have some residences in there and a strip mall or something, and then the thing is supposed to be behind it somewhere. So if it has something to do with residences being within 500 feet, I don't think that would fly, would it?
No. Ms. Mayday.
We've had some preliminary discussions with the property owner for the property mm-hmm. that surrounds the 4 South site. Their intent is to develop that as commercial and high-density residential.
Mm-hmm. And
going
there's
forward,
enough room for
and there's enough room
feet.
For that. In going forward with that project, we'll be working on a development agreement for that. Mm-hmm. So those details will be forthcoming. We've just started talking okay. about it, but that's their intent for that property.
Okay, thank you. Yes, sir. Please move forward, Mr. Trout.
If there's no 500-foot thing because of the size of it, they can still put their marijuana growing place in the back. Is that it?
I don't understand what you mean by that.
Well, the size of the property, obviously. You know, you're going to be able to get some greenhouses out there.
Mayor?
Yes, excuse
me. I don't think we're talking about any particular property tonight.
Yeah, let's let that go.
I mean,
go.
It all has
yes,
to
sir.
Do with zoning and stuff like that. That's okay. why I'm just concerned about it. Now,
okay.
is that one of the things you're going to be addressing?
It will be. It,
okay.
Any that's marijuana right. grows will be 500 feet from houses.
Something
yes, sir.
I really don't understand about this whole marijuana thing is everybody keeps saying, well, it's a nonprofit. Come on. If they're spending millions of dollars in taxes, they got to be making a whole lot of money.
That's not where we need
yeah,
to be. Thank you, sir. Thank
that,
you, sir.
Why would they want to keep
during,
expanding?
During the next break, the one that we're going to do at midnight, could you please talk to the attorney
yeah,
about
well,
the nonprofit?
I've heard enough. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. All right.
Okay.
Thank
did,
you.
Did you get that paper?
Yeah. Can you scroll all the way down to 4 South? That's good right there.
Yeah.
All right.
So this is going to be kind of hard to see, and I do know this is off topic, but this is a question I get frequently, so we can clear it up right now.
Let's get it done.
All right, so this is the 4 South property. The only area that they can cultivate medical marijuana in is about here because of the separation from the surrounding residential uses.
Okay.
So it's not a matter of them being able to go this way or this way or this way. Because they have separation down here from this residential, separation up here from this residential, separation over here from this residential. So it's a very small area. It's about 10 acres that they can use for the cultivation.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, okay, well, and then the other question was you're going to evaluate this during your meetings?
Yes, sir.
Decide what you're going to do.
We're not allowed to make a decision during
That's
a study
I mean.
Session.
Yeah.
We're just gathering information.
Yeah.
Okay?
Okay.
All right. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir, Mr. Mendoza.
Ruth, if once a grow is established, can a residence then move in within that 500-foot because they obviously would be aware of it being there? Or does it then kill any residential around
It's the opposite. The residential, the existence of the residential kills the marijuana use. So if, for instance, somebody bought a piece of property, bought one of these properties here that are, I think there's one that's vacant, they can build a house there. There's nothing that's precluding anyone from building a house on land within 500 feet of a marijuana use. The regulation goes the opposite direction. Instead of regulating the uses on the residential land?
A residence could move in within that.
Sure.
Within that after the.
If it's properly zoned.
After the grow is already. Okay.
But Ruth, isn't the 500 feet part of the ownership of the cultivator? Isn't the 500 feet buffer? It's not
necessarily. No. For instance, this is, let's go to.
Ruth, can I comment on this real quick?
Sure.
I think what Corey's question was, let's say the 10 acres is developed as a grow facility.
Mm-hmm.
Can next year somebody come in, buy the property from the existing owner next door, and build homes right up against that grow facility?
Sure they could.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Any others from the audience? Yes, ma'am.
Hello. I'm Kate O'Connor Massey. My husband, Mike, just spoke, so that makes me the farmer's wife. I actually work in biotech, pharmaceuticals, and medical devices, and I have for 25 years here in Chino Valley. So I know an awful lot about science and how drugs and products that are related to drugs are brought to the market, and I can tell you that this is a spectacular opportunity. I've never seen anything like it in my entire life. And I've worked on some major, major brands in my life. Never seen anything like this industry. I don't expect people to believe that, really. But I'd like to be able to give you one question to think about tonight and to help you with some of the answers to that question. This issue became a zoning issue because a small group of citizens who don't know very much about the plant, the industry, the potential, or anything else, mm-hmm. made it one.
Okay.
And?
Be careful here.
I understand. Okay. I understand.
Thank you.
But my understanding in reading the minutes and the direction from council mm-hmm. to staff mm-hmm. is that a small group of citizens came forward and brought their fears to the mm-hmm. council, and the council mm-hmm. responded by saying, let's find ways to restrict this industry. And that's what's in the record, so that's what mm-hmm. I've got to go on. My question is this, if it could be shown based on facts and science that those fears are unfounded, you wouldn't have a zoning problem. And so what I have for you tonight is a binder of medical cannabis overview, mm-hmm. and in this binder are 400 and some pages of facts about addiction, federal drug law, cannabis and crime, adolescent drug use, teen use of cannabis, whether it is or is not a gateway drug, clinical trials, Arizona and Colorado, medical cannabis laws and information and reports. I mm-hmm. submit this to the council. I could only afford to buy you one. It was $55. Mm-hmm. So I figured if you want to read it, I really hope you will, mm-hmm. because it contains a lot of information which, if it were well understood, would negate the need for any zoning change, mm-hmm. let alone some of the more draconian options that you have in your plan.
Okay, thank you. Any others? I know, yes, sir, as Mr. Nanke's coming forward, we as a council try to address the concerns of the citizens. 1 month it's tumbleweeds, one month it's barking dogs, 1 month it's something else. So we try to address the concerns of the citizens. Yes, sir, Mr. Nanke.
Mayor and Council, thank you for your time. You have to forgive us citizens. Most of us are not professionals or don't have any knowledge of planning and zoning regulations and laws, but we do have big concerns. So I'll try to keep to point.
Right.
We've had a lot of people speak tonight, I feel, on pro-marijuana attorneys and such that weren't talking to zoning at all. So I only be about 3.5 minutes as I speak. Under current town code and zoning regulations, Chino Valley has 3 active pot farms, 3 additional pot farms pending, I understand, including a massive 120,000 square foot facility proposed at the entrance of Chino Valley for a total of 6, with additional pot farms possibly climbing on board before anything is put in place to curtail what has become a serious stigma in our community.
Mr. Danke, can you move just a little bit away?
Hopefully. Okay. The mayor and town council can look ahead and see what Chino Valley will look like in the coming years if recreational pot use is legalized in Arizona. As an example, Denver is not only dealing with licensed recreational pot growers, but they are dealing with co-op growers banding together to grow large crops, making regulation enforcement a nightmare in Denver. And this is the only tip of the iceberg in Denver. The town of Chino Valley has an opportunity to make a tough, intelligent, forward-thinking decision to better the future of Chino Valley and its citizens. Many citizens are simply asking that our elected officials put zoning ordinances in place that currently exist in Prescott Valley. We are not asking for elected officials to do anything illegal. As a local citizen, I respectfully request of the mayor and town council to adopt and vote to approve most all the proposals, especially 3A. As to the pot farmers' proposal 1 and 2 represented by their lawyers, I understand that the citizens of Chino Valley may be sued by pot farmers with deep pockets, but let's make sure that the town obtains their own legal counsel from attorneys with expertise in land use and zoning laws that represents the citizens and what's best for citizens as a whole and not what is best for pot farmers. None of the citizens want to be sued, but we also do not want to be intimidated based upon the threat of legal action. Proposition 207 is not a free meal ticket for compensation to landowners. Diminished land values could be very difficult to prove by an appraiser. Remember, the town of Prescott Valley and Prescott have to contend with Proposition 207, and their zoning ordinances in Prescott Valley are stricter than Chino's when it comes to pot growers, and these ordinances have been in place for some time in that town. If the amendment, as I recommend, is put in place and current pot farmers want to expand, let them go through the same process we are going through through tonight so that the whole community can give input, because it affects the whole community, not just those in close proximity. Any agreements made between existing pot growers and town officials needs to take place in a public forum where citizens can voice their opposition or approval. We need to be sure due process of any proposals by pot growers and their lawyers is well documented for public input. This will allow the town to be free of any accusation of backroom deals. My last point, with the growing stigma, Chino Valley being known as the town with all the pot farms, who is going to compensate diminished property values of the citizens of Chino Valley? With the citizens of Chino Valley having nothing to gain but everything to lose in this study tonight, the choice, I hope, is clear to our elected officials. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. You got that almost at the money, 3.5 minutes. Thank you, Mr. Ninke. You drank a lot of cappuccino before you got here, I imagine. Yeah, all right. Cool. Oh, and we, as I said, this is a study session. We're here taking input. We've gotten a lot of it. Is there anyone else before we close? Yes, ma'am. And please stay with us on the zoning issue. Thank you.
This will be short.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Peggy Trout. I live here in Chino Valley. We moved here about 2 years ago. So we weren't here when all this started coming down.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but I just want to say one thing, just keep in the back of your mind. The citizens and the community of Chino Valley and our wishes.
Mm-hmm.
You were voted in by this community with the hopes that you would respect our wishes and do all in your power to honor them and do the right thing. We're not saying medical marijuana can be grown. We just don't want it grown here. Now, what's wrong with a Denny's or a Walmart?
Yes, ma'am.
You know?
Okay.
No,
Thank you. We're not going to range off into that. Thank you very much.
We're sticking to the zones on that.
Okay.
Denny's and Walmart.
All right.
Thank you.
We have a fairly large county around us, and it's not that Chino Valley is the only place in the country that marijuana can be grown, and it's sure not the only place it is being grown. It's being grown all over the state, and it's being used all over the state. The folks have asked us to investigate into this. That's what we're doing. And Mr. Best here got asked to investigate into some barking dog stuff or something here a while back, and his hair was brown before that. So. Okay. Any others? Yes, ma'am.
I'm Marcia Hilborn, and I've lived in Chino Valley over 33 years. I raised my family here, and my grandchildren are being raised here. And yes, it used to be a really nice town where you see the corn and the alfalfa growing along the road. And I have, can I ask two questions?
Yes, ma'am.
Why did you allow people to grow marijuana right off of 89, where people come through our town maybe for the first time and see that, you know? And another question is, I own a home. Is my property value going to go down? I'm concerned about that too.
Okay, thank you. We, every community deals with different challenges. Dewey Humboldt with the open pit mine, Prescott with their rehab centers. Every community has their challenges. That's why we're doing this study. Insofar as us allowing, it's not like the town put out a sign and said, please buy here, grow here. If the zoning is right, then you can do anything that's a permitted use within that zoning. The folks that bought that property wanted to do it for that purpose. And as was brought up earlier, probably in 6 months, if their facilities are finished, folks will drive in and they'll see a row of greenhouses, just like greenhouses that are all over Chino Valley that are growing flowers and tomatoes and Lord knows what else. No, the town didn't conspire to do this, okay, any more than it conspired to kill the KOA or to hide Walmart, all right? Any others before we close? Yes, sir.
You have to remember that we live here too. We have property here. We have the same concerns and issues that you have. So sometimes you have to make tough decisions. We're getting ready to make one in next month or so.
Mm-hmm.
So we're listening to both sides, and we're well aware of what's going on both sides.
You bet. And Mr. Nan, could you repeat that with the microphone a little closer? Yes, sir.
You have to remember that we live here too. We have the same concerns that all of you have. We have property here. We have concerns of that. I moved here about 9 years ago. I intend to stay here until they put some dirt over me. And it's a nice place to live, and I want it to continue to be a nice place.
Okay. In regards to the marijuana subject, as I said, it's a volatile subject, but as was brought up earlier, I run into folks that are pro-marijuana, and I run into folks that are against marijuana. And I have folks in the town that tell me, Mayor, represent us. And I go, I'd have to be schizophrenic to represent everybody in the town. So what we do is we try and do what we feel is best for the town. Within the general plan, we're trying to work through that. As our vice mayor said, we're having to make some tough decisions. But I have learned, especially since I've been in public office, not everybody in the town thinks the same way I do. And everybody here has a different opinion on a lot of different subjects. So we're going to try and work our way through it, try and do what's best for the town. If you're praying, folks, please pray for us. That probably was against the law, so I'll say it again. If you're praying, folks, please pray for us. Okay. If there's, yes, sir.
just for clarification, is there, we have how many already established? And they are here, correct?
Six, correct.
There is no going back on them?
No, there's no going back on those.
Okay. So as far as the, keep bringing up the four south, it's kind of a moot point at that, at this point?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. That's why we're having this study. Folks have asked us to look at the possibly limiting them. Miss Mayday, please get us out of here before tomorrow morning, okay?
I can't make a motion.
That was it? You're going to show us the currently permitted facilities?
They were asking.
There they are.
I do have a question, Ruth. I'm sorry, Miss Mayday.
Sure.
In that circle, you show 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 separate parcels. Are those, like, is the three together, is that one?
Right, so this is all of the property, again, the former KOA.
Yeah, I understand.
Was divided into three parcels.
Okay, so that's all one.
That's all one.
So in that circle, there's three.
Exactly. And then this one, I tried to click on just one, and I couldn't get it to label or to highlight just one. I got two. So it's the smaller one of those two.
So actually, we have 3, 4, 5, 6 at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all that's working right now? Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. The chair would entertain a motion.
Do you want to direct staff?
Pardon me? To adjourn.
All right. We have a motion to adjourn.
Hold on 1 second. We are adjourning?
Yes.
Okay, so you didn't want to, at what point do we discuss next meeting?
Yeah, we can't, gotcha. We can't vote. We're simply taking
okay.
input this time.
Gotcha, okay.
All right.
Gotcha, okay.
All right,
yeah.
Cool.
Exactly.
Yeah, we were not noticed as a town council meeting, so we can't vote
gotcha.
On anything.
No, and I didn't expect
okay.
us to.
All right. Chair would entertain a motion.
We got a motion. We got a second and we got a whoa.
A motion, a second, and a whoa. Okay. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Well, Jamie, you're really